Welcome. On this Memorial Day, it's nice to be together. It is the magnificent King of the Earth who invites us this evening into his throne of grace. We celebrate your goodness, Lord, and we praise you for your grace towards us, confessing that we are completely unworthy of such favor. We know that apart from your gracious empowerment, all our attempts at godly love and faithful service are utterly futile. Apart from the Holy Spirit's power, we neither could nor would honor Jesus as Lord. Apart from the intercessory work of Christ, we know that we would falter. And apart from the grace you give us to persevere, we would surely fall away. Apart from the purifying power of your word, we would be as a ship without a rudder. So we gather to express our love for you and our ongoing need for your love and grace. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to continue singing our praise to God and thanking him and expressing our dependence on him using a song. It's from our new, the CRC hymnal. It's called Saranam. And Saranam is a Tamil word used in like Singapore, Sri Lanka, and kind of Southern Asia. And it means shelter or surrender, to take shelter or to surrender. So we'll sing that.
And through it. We come to our rock, our refuge, our shelter, to express our praise to our God, as well as bring our thanksgivings and our confessions, as well as our dependence upon our God. We're delighted that you've joined us tonight. For those who've joined us online or local cable, welcome to you. And we pray that you too might find that God is your refuge, your strength, your rock. And as we've come to him, our God greets us. Receive his greeting. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God the Father, from God the Son, and from God the Holy Spirit. And all God's people receive that greeting by saying together, Amen. As God has greeted us, I invite you to turn to those around you and greet them in our Lord's name.
As we continue, I'm going to read some verses from Psalm 86, again expressing our dependence, our utter dependence on God. Hear me, Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Guard my life, for I am faithful to you. Save your servants who trust you. You are my God. Have mercy on me, Lord, for I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant, Lord, for I put my trust in you. You, Lord, are forgiving and good, abounding in love to all who call to you. Hear my prayer, Lord. Listen to my cry for mercy. When I am in distress, I call to you because you answer me. Among the gods, there is none like you, Lord. No deeds can compare with yours. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name, for you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God.
We do come tonight to express our dependency upon our God, but we also come to express our thanksgiving for what he has done and how he has provided for us. And out of that, we express it by giving. And our designated offering for today is for the Abide and Vine Disciples Church in Harbel. The deacons will be at the door to receive your gifts. Certainly, you can also give to TC Ed Fund. Let's turn to our Lord in prayer. O gracious God, indeed, we need you. not every hour, but every second. Our lives depend upon you, your goodness and your grace. And we thank you, O God, for that invitation to come, to worship you, to express our thanksgiving for who you are. You are indeed merciful. You are loving. You are almighty. You are righteous. We praise you for how you continue to grace this world, to grace our lives. Lord, we praise you for this world that you made, a world in which you have created with beauty and wonder. We thank you, O God, for today, a day in which we could stop and ponder once again your goodness and your grace in our lives. We praise you for the gift of rest, as well as the gift of work. And as we come to you tonight, we pray, O God, that we might indeed work for you with all of our might, trusting that our work is not in vain, but that you will use it to build your kingdom. O God, as we gather on this day, we praise you for the freedoms that we enjoy. We praise you that we can freely come to worship the one and only God. We thank you for those who have defended our freedoms, even at the cost of their own lives. And on this Memorial Day weekend, we do want to say thank you for those who have served and continue to serve. We pray for peacekeepers around the world, that you will protect them as they seek to protect us. Oh God, we do pray for that peace to pervade our entire world. You are that peace-loving God, and may we walk in your ways. Oh God, again, we say thank you. Thank you for the gifts that you poured out on for us, for food and clothing, shelter. We thank you for the technology that we enjoy. We thank you for health. Sometimes we take it for granted until it's missing. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, most importantly, for that cross that has set us free to live that new life for you. And thank you, Lord, for that promise of eternal life because of what you have done, Lord. Thank you that we can live with that confident hope that you are with us even to the end of the age. Thank you, O God, for your Holy Spirit that you poured out on the church. And as we remember you, O God, have exalted your Son to that rightful place on the throne, and that you, O Jesus, are ruling over all things. And we thank you, Lord, for that ongoing presence by which you rule this world. Thank you for your Spirit that comforts us, that guides us. We look forward to next Sunday as we gather together to remember that day in which you poured your Spirit out on your people, on your church. Thank you. Lord, as we think about your church, we do pray for your church, both gathered here and around the world. We pray for those that love you, that they might be united in your service. We pray for this body called the Christian Reformed Church, that branch. And as delegates get ready for the annual synod meeting, we pray that you will equip them with wisdom, discernment, that they might seek your good and perfect will, and that we might be united. Oh God, we pray for your church in Harbel, the Abide and Vine Disciples Church. We thank you for our brothers and sisters there, and we pray that you'll continue to equip them and empower them to be lights in that place. Oh God, we pray for one another. Lord, you are holy and you are merciful. And we confess to you and to one another in the whole communion of saints that we are not perfect. In thought, word, and deed, we have not completely carried out your will. Forgive us for what we have done or what we've left undone. Forgive us when we do not love you with our whole heart and mind and strength in our soul. Forgive us when we have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive us for those times that we have not listened to your call to serve as Christ served, where we have not been true to the mind of Christ, where we have grieved you, O Holy Spirit. O God, we confess this to you, our unfaithfulness, our own pride, our own hypocrisy and impatience. We confess to you our self-indulgent appetites and our exploitation of others. We confess to you our anger, our frustration, our envy of those who perhaps we, in our judgment, have more than us. We confess our love for worldly goods and comforts and our times of not being satisfied. We confess our negligence in prayer and worship and our failure to commend the faith that is in us to others. Accept our repentance, O God, for the wrongs we have done, for our neglect of human need and suffering, and our indifference to injustice and cruelty. O God, with that in mind, we do pray for your world. We pray for leaders of nations, that they might be reconciled to one another in pursuit of your justice and your peace. We pray for your world. We think particularly of Ukraine. And again, we ask for a truce to this war. We pray, Lord, that this would stop, this evil. We pray for those who have been displaced, for those who grieve loss. Again, we pray for peace. We pray for others who suffer from prejudice or greed or violence. We pray that the heart of humanity may warm with your tenderness. We pray for prisoners of politics or religion, for all refugees. We pray particularly for those who carry your name, who are persecuted for the faith. Keep their faith strong. Turn the hearts of the persecutors to you, O God. We pray for those who are pressed down because they lack. We think about Afghanistan, where 1 million children are starving. We pray for places like Somalia or Nigeria, where there is such a need for food, basic commodity of life, Lord. We, with so much, help us to be giving, and we pray for resources to be given to these who long for life. Pray for all in need, because of famine, or perhaps because of a groaning creation, that they might know the hope of your faithfulness through the help of others. Lord, we pray for this nation. Again, we are so saddened to hear more violence. We're bewildered, Lord. We haven't recovered from the last act of violence. Some of us are paralyzed with fear. We fear for our own lives, for the lives of our children and our children's children. We don't know what's happened to the world we thought we knew. We who fear confess our fear. Fill us with your love, for that perfect love casts out fear. We thank you for your promise that you are with us, that your rod and your staff can comfort us. Oh God, we do pray for people whose lives are truly endangered. Would you make safe havens for them? Would you lead them to places of light and life? Lord, it seems our world is incensed with hatred. And our instinct is to overcome evil with evil. That's not your way, Lord. And we confess our own hate. Warm our hearts with compassion. Help us to pursue your way. Grant us your wisdom as we seek your kingdom by turning our cheek and walking another mile. We pray for people whose hatred has led to death. As you did with the Apostle Paul, would you encounter them on the road? Would you, with your very presence, transform threats into lives lived for you? Oh God, I, along with my friends here tonight, feel numb with this violence. Rising death toll spins past our eyes, and yet years of images of violence have dulled our senses. Lord, awaken us. We who are numb confess our numbness. Sharpen our senses, cause us to care, even if that means feeling the pain of heartbreaking sadness. Teach us empathy. Help us to weep with those who weep, and we pray for those who weep. Would you be their consolation? You know the pain of betrayal, of abandonment, of even death. Would you heal the wounds of all? Would you also give them something to to look forward to, hope, joy, change. God, we lay this before you tonight. We pray for your world. We pray for your groaning creation, which longs for that redemption. We pray that we might be good stewards of your creation, Lord. In this agricultural area, you've given us a heavy responsibility. So may we do well. But we are totally dependent upon you, O God, for strength. We pray for rain. We pray for sunshine. We pray for that growing crop. We pray that through it we might be distributors of your resources. God, we also remember those in our body who suffer from sickness. Maybe they're on that journey of cancer. We ask for healing. But in the midst of it all, we pray for your comforting presence. We pray for others who experience mental or emotional illness, whose days may be long and heavy, who may feel lonely or fearful or hopeless. We ask that you would come along them, O Holy Spirit, the Comforter, and we pray that we as a body might carry each other's burdens. We pray for those who turn their back on you, O God. Some of them are our family and friends, and once again we plead with you, use us, use circumstances to turn them back to you. Oh, God of compassion, we bring these prayers to you tonight because you've told us to. You've told us to ask, to seek, to knock. So we come to you with hearts wide open. We pray, Lord, as we open your word tonight, that we might hear that word. We thank you so much for that word. And as you taught your disciples, we pray that you will teach us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Invite us to hear from God's word tonight from Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11. As we continue to read God's word, utilizing the lens of the Heidelberg Catechism, we are in that third section, the third section in which we speak about our gratitude to God for what he has done. How shall we then live in light of this new life in Jesus Christ? Well, over the past few weeks, we've been thinking about God's perfect 10, those statutes of liberty, those 10 commandments. And that's a way that we can gratefully respond to our God. But our Lord also reminds us that we can pray. And as our catechism notes, that prayer is that chief form of gratitude, and we'll look at that in a little bit tonight. But first of all, we're going to start with the basics and turn to Luke chapter 11, where Jesus' disciples come to him with that request. Let's read together from Luke chapter 11. One day, Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples." He said to them, "When you pray, say, 'Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. And lead us not into temptation.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Suppose you have a friend. You go to him at midnight and say, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread. A friend of mine on a journey has come to me, and I have no food to offer him.' And suppose the one inside answers, 'Don't bother me. The door is already locked, and my children and I are in bed. I can't get up and give you anything.' I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you the bread because of friendship, yet because of your shameless audacity, he will surely get up and give you as much as you need. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, the door will be opened. Which of you fathers, if your son asks for a fish, will give him a snake instead? Or if he asks for an egg, will give him a scorpion? If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? This, my friends, is the word of the Lord. I'd much rather pray than talk about it. But our Lord talked about it, and he taught us. And so we turn to this model prayer. And by the way, I emphasize model. It's not this liturgy that we say without even thinking about it. But it's a model. And he said, this is how you should pray. And as you read in our text, it's the disciples who made this request. Jesus had been praying, and the disciples noted the power of prayer in Jesus' life. And that's what they wanted. That's what they longed for. And you always turn to those who are experts for advice on what they do well. And they didn't ask, teach us how to do miracles. They didn't ask, teach us how to teach. No, teach us how to pray. And tonight we begin our study of prayer, utilizing the lens of the catechism. Tonight we briefly touch on the how, and the as we listen to the catechism, we talk about the why, the how, and what we should pray. And just a side note, it doesn't address when to pray. And I bring that to your attention because within the Christian tradition, as well as in other religions, there are times for prayer, morning prayers, midday prayers, evening prayers, which we can learn a lot from. But in our tradition, we have no prescribed prayer times. Not because we want to pray less, but rather we are people who want to pray more. As we sang earlier, I need you every hour. We are called to pray continually and give thanks in all circumstances. So prayer is not isolated to maybe a few minutes a day, but it's our life. We'll get into that in a little bit. But I begin, first of all, with that question of the catechism. Why do Christians need to pray? Will you join me in that answer? Because prayer is the most important part of the thankfulness God requires of us. And also because God gives his grace and Holy Spirit only to those who pray continually and groan inwardly, asking God for these gifts and thanking God for them. So why pray? Well, we know these reasons in the catechism. God seeks it. Prayer is the best we can offer of our love response, and it's essential in a healthy walk with God. I would have you note that prayer is a response to God. It's a response to God. A God who longs to communicate. I think of that story of Samuel, little Samuel, where God wanted to talk into his life. And his response was, speak, for your servant is listening. It's rooted in that gratitude. It's that conversational part of our love relationship with God. I think of the analogy, prayer for the Christian is like breathing. It's like breathing. You can't live without it. Now, you don't have to think about breathing. You're breathing here tonight. None of you are concentrating and thinking, oh, I gotta breathe. No, it's natural. That's why it's more difficult to hold your breath than it is to breathe. When you enter into that spiritual relationship as a member of the family of God, he walks with you, he talks with you, he's with you. Sadly, many hold their spiritual breaths for long periods, thinking brief moments of God are sufficient. We are continually in that presence of God, constantly breathing that truth that he is with us. And I remind you of that. And I remind you of this because sometimes prayer can just be a routine, a ritual. We rely on some things to do automatically, like riding a bike or tying our shoelaces, or the results of things that we've done so often that our bodies perform them without much thought. Habits like putting on the seatbelt become so fully developed that we no longer realize we're doing them. but there are other parts of our life. We don't want to rely on program habits to get through. We need to give full attention to relationships. Some of you may be married. You know, your spouse can tell the difference between an automatic love you and a heartfelt expression. Your children can tell the difference between how was school today and how you really doing. So God knows the difference between that expression of love and our automatic rote prayers. And Jesus gives us this believer's prayer in response to that disciple's request. And it's not so much teach us how to pray, but teach us to pray. Teach us to have that longing for that relationship with God. Prayer is also that fruit of an obedient life. You see on the screen the words of the psalmist who longs for that seeking God's face. Lord, my heart seeks of you. I seek to walk with you. I seek to experience your presence in my life. I offer myself to you. Think of the words of Romans chapter 12, verse 1. You know them well. That call to respond to God's mercy by offering our bodies, our whole being as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and spiritual worship. I say that because we can sometimes confine our prayers to just requests. I must confess that I sometimes drift into bringing a satchel full of requests, like stopping at a drive-thru burger joint. Give me one solved problem, two blessings without the hassle, and, oh, could you add some patience as I'm in a hurry? No. Let's remember, prayer is this intimacy with God which feeds our soul in order that our love and walk with God might be deepened. Where prayer keeps our lives focused. Deep prayer unearths hidden things. Through deep prayer, joy is birthed, faith is strengthened, hope is kindled, power is released. I emphasize this point because for many, prayer is just getting things from God. I think I mentioned it before. I've got a little book on my shelf that a friend of mine shared with me, John DeVries. He was involved with mission in India. He was also a pastor in Grand Rapids. And he wrote a little book with a question mark. Does it pay to pray? Does it pay to pray? And this book came from a man in his congregation, a businessman. And this man said, well, I can't keep my business running unless I can see some benefits for what I'm doing. Well, it also was grounded in the fact that John had invited members of his congregation to join him every morning at 7 a.m., 7 days a week. And they've been praying. They've been praying for like 6 months. 30 or 40 people had showed up regularly. And as Pastor John noted, they experienced thrilling and fulfilling times as they saw answers to prayer. And they carefully tracked them for the church to see. John writes, 1 week we noted 49 distinct answers to prayer. But then something happened. It seemed that God turned off the power. We prayed, but no answers came. It soon got so bad that we hardly dared to pray for anything. We seemed to get the opposite of what we were asking. If a couple had marital problems, it seemed they were certain to get a divorce. If somebody was seriously ill, we prayed, it seemed that they would get worse. And so the businessman came with that, in that context, with that question, does it pay? Does it pay? And sadly, we can run into that same sort of mentality. Does it pay? Well, John spun the question around. Does it pay to love your spouse? Does it pay to talk to your spouse? Of course. Think how troubled our marriage would be if we didn't talk. Does it pay to talk to your children? Are you doing it because of you or out of love? Do you evaluate every conversation with a dear friend in terms of what you get out of it? That's why we must never prostitute prayer degraded it into something mechanical. It's that living, natural, exciting way of sharing our hearts with the one who loves us. Speaking of that, you love to pray. But if I would ask you tonight, what are the five things you love to do in life? Would you put prayer there? Seriously. I invite you to love to pray. Going into the Father's house, experiencing His grace. I invite you to understand this is vital for your soul. As noted, it's rooted in gratitude. It's that conversational part of our love relationship with the one who first loved us. It's initiated by the Lord who longs to dialogue. Imagine if you're married, if your spouse said, you know what, I don't really want to talk to you. And you ask them why. Well, it's kind of boring. I don't get anything out of it. How selfish would that be? There's a dialogue with the King of Kings. He promises to be with us. Perhaps there's imbalance in our prayers. As mentioned, could it be so focused on what we want that we're not listening? Because prayer is two-way, by the way. It's that conversational part of our loving relationship with God. Are we listening? Are we communicating? I'm reminded of an old story. A couple came to a judge, and they wanted a divorce. Now, this couple had been married for decades, and so the judge was a little bit curious about this. So he asked the wife, do you have grounds for your divorce? And she replied, oh, we have plenty. We own like 10 acres. Confused, the judge asked, do you have a grudge against him? She responded, oh, we have a large one. We can park 3 vehicles. Well, the judge was getting frustrated. He asked, well, does he beat you up? Oh, no. I beat him up every morning as I'm up at 6 a.m. to exercise, and he's still sleeping. Well, the judge asked, why do you want a divorce? Well, she said, we don't seem to communicate. Sometimes we're so busy asking, we don't listen. Oh, indeed, there is that place of dependence on God, that inward groaning, as the Catechism puts it. But Jesus responds, as we heard tonight in Luke as well as in Matthew, come, express your dependence. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened. Trust me in this. Trust me, he says. But I underscore the importance of balance in our prayer. We can ask, but there's adoration. There's confession. There's thanksgiving. And I believe that prayers of adoration have to be learned. Anne Lamott, a writer, theologian, puts it this way. She notes, the cries for help come in a way naturally. But we need to learn to say, wow, God. We need to practice that art of focusing on who God is, His attributes. We also need to focus on gratitude, she goes on. She points out, we teach our children to be grateful. So why is it when we grow a bit older, we forget this part? Could it be our inattention as we get caught up in the whirl and stresses of life? We get caught up in the demands of home and life, and like Jack's beanstalk, our obligations grow. We might see a sunset and we're drawn into analysis rather than doxology. Well, prayer involves that confession. Also adoration, thanksgiving. Now we need to move on. Secondly, how does God want us to pray? What's the kind of prayer that pleases God and that He listens to? First, we must pray from the heart to no other than the one true God revealed to us in His Word, asking for everything God has commanded us to ask for. Secondly, we must fully recognize our need and misery so that we humble ourselves in God's majestic presence. And third, we must rest on this unshakable foundation, even though we don't deserve it, God will surely listen to our prayer because of Christ our Lord. That's what God promised in His Word. So we pray. How to pray? Well, first of all, knowing God through His Word. I know it's not always possible, but reading the Bible and responding to the Lord in His Word is vital. If we could see the heart of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in prayer, we would be drawn into praise and thanksgiving, I believe, more often. It's easy to think that God is so exalted that our adoration makes no difference. No, it makes a difference. It makes a difference on us as we remember who we're talking to. Let's not get caught up in inattention. Oh, we pray to that divine lover. We pray to the God of the Bible with honesty and humility in Jesus' name. Prayer starts there. It requires that loving awe of remembering who God is. I recall the story of Moses. Remember how Moses was invited up to the top of the mountain to meet with God? Oh, nobody else could go because it wasn't safe. That was Moses' day. We are invited to come up to the mountain to be in the presence of God because of Jesus the Christ. But we come with that sense of awe, not a casual familiarity, but neither a stilted formality. We are awakened to the magnitude of communing with God. I love the way E.M. Bounds puts it. God is here, before me, behind me, on my right, and on my left. He who fills immensity has come to me here. I am now about to bow at His feet and speak to Him. I may pour forth my desires before Him, and not one syllable from my lips will escape His ear. I may speak to Him as I would to the dearest friend I have here on earth. We pray, knowing God. We pray to know ourselves. In prayer, there is a way that God opens our own souls to see ourselves. Eugene Peterson, in his book on prayer, says, prayer takes place in the middle voice. In grammar, active voice is when we take action. Passive voice is when we receive that action. But in the middle voice, we both act and are acted upon. We enter into the middle, the sanctuary. While we are full participants in that grace-filled work of prayer, the work of prayer doesn't depend upon us. Thanks be to God for the Holy Spirit who helps us with our prayers. Many times we might only have fragmentary glimpses of the heavenly glory, yet the Holy Spirit accompanies us in our prayers. When we stumble, the Spirit straightens out our syntax. While when we pray with muddy motives, the Spirit purifies the stream. When we see through that glass darkly, the Spirit has a way of adjusting and focusing what we are asking. The Spirit reshapes, refines, reinterprets our feeble prayers. Praise be to God. But we pray in the mediator's name. It's Jesus who taught us those words. I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these. Let that sink in. Because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. Now, worldly-minded people, prosperity gospel teachers have done much damage to those words of Christ. Ask anything in my name. No, we must distinguish between our needs and our wants. In our consumer-driven age, it's often about what I want. No, we must not tie prayer into that. We miss the point. I mean, God knows our needs even before we ask Him. But this is the conversation with the one who loves us. And we pour our hearts out in Jesus' name. But it's only in Jesus' name. He is the one who's opened that door by which we can commune with the triune God. And prayer begins and ends not with my needs, but with the glory of God. Finally tonight, what did God command us to pray for, everything we need, spiritually, physically, as to embrace the prayer that Christ taught, Christ our Lord himself taught us. And over the next few weeks, we'll look at those petitions of the Lord's Prayer. But I remind you again, as we pray in our times with God, as we travel down the road, as we're out in that workplace, we walk with God. And may we remember some of the keys of that healthy prayer. Grounded in grace, awareness that God is present. We pray for our needs, not necessarily our wants, unless they are aligned with God's wants. As we listen to this, we heard Jesus' story. Oh, actually two stories. About how the Heavenly Father looks at us as a perfect Heavenly Father, as that friend who does life with us. But he also recognizes our helplessness and our dependence upon him. And so we pray with that attitude. I think of that, for example, we teach our children to fold our hands. Why do we do that? Why do we fold our hands? Well, some of you might say, well, so that we don't fidget. No, 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 wait a minute. If you go back in the ancient Near East world, when someone approached the king or maybe the queen, you folded your hands to note that you came with nothing. A sign of humility. It's old Halsby in his classic book on prayer noted, as far as I can see, prayer has been ordained only for the helpless. For only the helpless can truly pray. I think of the story Jesus told of the Pharisee and tax collector. You remember that? Whose prayer was answered? The one who humbled himself and cried out for mercy. Oh, tonight, just laying some groundwork as we think about our Lord's teaching to pray. Not necessarily how, remember? The emphasis on teaching to pray with this longing for the one who loves us. Longing for that intimacy. And I remind you again of the benefits of a healthy prayer life. It gives us perspective. In our quaking and shaking world, and we wonder why is there so much evil, I'm reminded of Asaph, who had the same question. And he said, when I try to understand all this, it was oppressive to me. Till I entered the sanctuary of God. How vital to have that kind of perspective in our world today. Secondly, prayer nourishes our souls. A healthy soul, I think of the classic book on prayer by Dallas Willard, who writes, our soul is like a stream of water, which gives strength, direction, and harmony to every other area of our life. When that stream is it should be, we are constantly refreshed and exuberant in all we do because our soul itself is then profusely rooted in the vastness of God and his kingdom, including nature. And all else within us is enlivened and directed by that stream. How vital for our soul to be healthy. And that comes through that prayer life. Thirdly, as we've noted already, prayer helps us know ourselves. Sometimes we can get so caught up in stuff of this life that we lose perspective of who we are. And remember again, God knows everything about us, as we read in Hebrews 4. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account. But he says, come. Come. I know. Just come. Know what you're doing, what you're thinking. Just come. Let's talk this over. And for me, and I trust you also, prayer provides that confident hope. As we heard from Luke, as well as Matthew, ask, knock, seek. And there's results. Not to pay to pray, but for our own soul, for our own place in God's kingdom. And finally, prayer points to our faithful Lord. Turn again to Asaph, who concludes Psalm 73 with those words, whom have I in heaven but you? And earth has nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Thanks be to God for the gift of prayer. I conclude with an illustration I think I've shared with you before. Timothy Keller has written a book on prayer. And he gives this metaphor, which has been helpful for me, evaluating my own prayer life. He said, imagine that your soul is a boat with both oars and a sail. Are you sailing? Which means, are you flourishing with the wind at your back? And God is so real, and you're experiencing His love. You experience the richness in your time alone with Him, and others are being influenced by the Spirit through you. That's sailing. Or maybe you're rowing. This means you might need to work at it. You may not experience the flourishing, but you refuse self-pity or hardness of heart. So you keep pressing, keep serving, despite the dryness. Or are you drifting? Which means you might be experiencing the conditions of rowing, the dryness and difficulties, and you begin to shut down. You don't feel like approaching the Lord. Just going through the motions. You might give into self-centeredness. There's one more category. Are you sinking? Your soul feels empty. The numbness of your heart becomes hard as you give into resentment. The point Keller brings up is that there are things in life that we can't control, circumstances and the like. But there are things that we are responsible for. And that is placing ourselves in the flow of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, that wind. And that comes through prayer. Deep, intimate prayer with the Christ. And it's Jesus who reminds us, keep on. Remember Luke 18? Keep on. Don't give up. For our Lord aches over His people. And particularly those who turn to Him. For He is not only our Lord and Savior, but a friend who walks with us and longs to carry those burdens. With that, let's turn to our Lord in prayer. Lord, teach us to pray like You, to have that communion with the Father, and by Your Spirit, empower us. May prayer never become a ritual, but rather that love relationship with You. God, as we think about this most beautiful gift of communing with You, we pray that You will be honored. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite us to respond to God's word tonight and sing a hymn that most of you are familiar with, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. If you're able, I invite you to stand as we sing this song.
To God.
In response to God's word tonight, I invite you to join me in this response. Seated at the right hand of the Father, Jesus hears our prayers and pleads our cause before the Father. And we say together,
We humbly ask God to grant us more grace, to be diligent in our service, faithful in our devotion to Christ, creative in our sharing of the gospel, clear in our testimony to the world, and steadfast in our defense of the truth. We thank God for the glorious gift of prayer and the power of the life-giving Spirit.
And so we go, in the name of our Lord and Savior, who sends us out with his blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the ongoing presence of the empowering Spirit, and all God's people say together,
Jesus, how do we express?